Hello, and welcome to Tech and Learning Future-Proofing Your District Plan Conference. A special thank you to our sponsors, Catch-On, Classcraft, FileWave, Global Teletherapy, GradeCam, Sanford Programs, and thank you to all our association partners. Today's virtual conference is focused on taking the lessons learned from current remote learning programs to create long-term plans that support effective teaching and learning both online and in person. I want to remind everyone to log into the conference hub using the link sent in your confirmation email. Once you are logged in, you can visit a sponsor booth to learn about their offerings and book a meeting or live chat with them. See your personalized agenda. Network with over 1,000 of today's attendees via the register directory and chat features. Access all of the conference resources in the download section. And win prizes. Throughout the conference hub, you will find several buttons to enter yourself into a passport to prizes. Please visit all the pages using the navigation bar on top of the page. Every time you find a button and fill out the form, you will earn one entry into the raffle. All entries are eligible for a series of prize drawings, only one prize per participant. You can enter once for every button you find. We will announce winners via email at the end of the conference. Before we begin, I'd like to cover a few housekeeping items. If you have any questions for the presenters during the webinars, please submit them through the Zoom chat. Please know we capture all questions and our presenters are happy to answer them as time permits. Today's slides and additional resources are available and can be accessed in the Downloads tab of the Conference Hub. We encourage you to download any resources that you may find useful. Be sure to use the conference hashtag TLTechLive in social posts. Please join me in thanking our terrific speakers, and I also want to thank you for joining us today. Please join me in welcoming our presenter, Dr. Kecia Ray.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back. I'm so glad to see you here. California is 73 degrees and we're hotter here in Tennessee. That's crazy, let me tell you. I see OPS people are here. We got a lot of people from Ohio, Greenville, Tennessee. That's not too far from me. So really glad to see all. Oh, Kentucky's here. Hey, Angie. Awesome. See, we can all be friends with each other because we are technologists, but also because there's no sports. So we don't have to debate. See, normally I would see Kentucky and a little piece of me would kind of dry up a little bit. But now I'm like, yay, Angie. So glad you guys are all here. Well, you're in the session, Selecting Digital Content to Engage Learners. And let me get my slide share or my screen share. It's gotten better as the day has gone on. Here we go. Can you see my screen? I depend on chat. You guys have to let me know you can see stuff. Oh, New Jersey's here. Okay, good. Yay, good job. Oh, Flagstaff, Arizona. Wow, that's hot there, right? Okay, good. All right, now let me get it on. Hello. Excellent. Now, can you see everything? Oh, Talon says it's beautiful. Good deal. All right. All right, let's get this puppy going. See, look at that. I'm on a Mac and using a PowerPoint. Doesn't work, but it does really good for closed captioning. PowerPoint does. So tell me, put in the chat, what is the purpose of content? What is the purpose of content in your opinion? We got 58 people here. So we should have 58 responses. Just kidding, I had 110 people in my previous one. I did not have 110 responses. Accessibility and ease, very good. Mm-hmm. Foundational learning, okay. Help students with information for learning. Provide context, teach the standards. Very good, Nikki. Help make connections. Okay, very good. Mm-hmm. Awesome. Knowledge and deeper learning. Good deal, Judy. Okay. All right, good. Well, we're going to talk about how we select content, how we curate content for our districts in this session. And we're gonna come from a place where we're pretending like we're going to be dependent on blended learning or digital learning, because the reality is we probably are going to be dependent on some form of technology-assisted learning. So this curation for digital learning is Tim Clark. I've never met him, but I do follow him on Twitter, and I check out his website frequently. He is a big BYOT, big bring your own technology guy, but he does a lot of really great resources like this to kind of help you have assets to use for professional development, and I've used them a lot. So curation for digital learning involves all these places. You have to evaluate the content, and then you have to think about where you're going to store it. Every once in a while, you need to go through and decide if you want to keep it or not, especially if it's teacher created. You have to think about how you're going to sustain the content and how you're going to have a good plan of action for that. A lot of people, a lot of districts have like an approval process, and then they communicate with the district or with the users what that approval process is and how they're going to be able to access the approved content. Some load everything in their learning management system and make it only available there. So there's a lot of variety in curating content. This is the digital content life cycle that I like to follow. You've got to select digital content, especially if you're doing blended learning and leaning into the digital models. But you've got all of these little beautiful colored olive things are things that you need to consider when you're selecting it. Who created it, how it was created. You've got to be able to describe it to people so they know what they're getting and how they should be using it. You've got to be able to manage it. It has to go into some kind of a system. It has to be discoverable in that management. I've had plenty of learning object repositories where you couldn't really find anything, and I'm telling the teachers it's easy to find, and they're like, no, it's impossible to find. So always look at it from a teacher's login or a student's login so that you can make sure it's really discoverable. And then the frequency of using it and reusing it, and basically determining what you need to delete and being okay with deleting it. And some stuff you're going to preserve. But this is essentially the life cycle for digital content. And there's five different types of digital content that I like to speak about. The first is paid subscriptions. And the paid subscriptions, quite frankly, could be adopted, supplemental. They could be any of these things. But you can also have just plain old paid subscriptions that you just like it and you get it. Accelerated Reader is one of those, right? It's not an adopted text. It's not technically supplemental. Certainly not OER, and it's not teacher created. But it is a paid subscription that you can get, and it's online. And it gives your kids access to online reading and kind of a quiz-based fashion. Adopted text, we're going to talk a little bit more about that in a minute, but adopted text are a type of digital content supplemental to adoptive text, and that supplemental can be truly supplemental, like in addition to the adopted text, or it could be materials that are published by the publisher but not included in the package of the adoption. Open education resources, we're going to talk about that, and then teacher created. So we're going to talk about all these things. So before we talk about all these things, I want you to check out a website that I use frequently to give me some good guidance on what kind of content to use and think about. And I'm actually on an advisory committee for Common Sense where we talk about privacy and security and safety. And what I want you to do is take a few minutes. I'm going to play some music. And I want you to explore Common Sense Media. And if you're familiar with Common Sense Media, I want you to explore their newest site called Wide Open School. So I'm gonna give you about 2 to 3 minutes ish to look at these two websites. And then as you look at them, I want you to post in the chat your comments. And I'm going to get the music going so you can take a look at that. All right, I'm back. It looks like you guys really enjoyed checking out those sites. And, you know, Wide Open Schools, it does have a lot of resources. Basically, what happened is Common Sense decided, you know, when remote learning got started, everybody started sending emails saying, this is free, this is free, this is free. And if you know anything about Jim Stare, you know that he, you know, the hair on his arm just stood up straight. He was like, wait a minute. And he put together Wide Open School and made it available. So it vets all of those free resources. Now, there are fee resources in there, too, but it tells you that they're fee. And it makes it easy for it to turn on the subscription in Wide Open School. It's a really good resource. And I highly recommend it. So now let's talk about textbook adoption. not necessarily our favorite subject, but one thing that I want to like just make available to you here, or I guess not make available, but make a suggestion to you here is when you think about your textbook adoption, if you even use textbooks, you really need to think about who's in the room when you're making the decision. And if you have an adoption coming up, like there clearly is one in Alabama, then think about the advantage it is for you to move to a digital curriculum in the adoption process. And make sure that when you are when you're making the decision and you're deciding on that adoption, that you've got people with a technology background in the room and teachers who use technology to teach with in the room. Make sure you have the right mix of people in that committee to make the decision so that you don't end up with products that you aren't crazy about. And also make sure you've got somebody from the IT department in the room so that you are selecting content that will run on your infrastructure and that will run on the devices that you have selected. Super important. I have met more than one superintendent who they went through an adoption and their series that they adopted did not run on the computers that they had. So please make sure that you're going to do that when you are in your adoption process. These are just some examples of adopted text. And be aware that when you go through adoption, and I'm sure all of you know this, but just for the sake of saying it, you know, when you go through an adoption, you can buy various pieces of the adopted materials. Make sure that you think about getting those digital pieces and make sure that you have a plan for professional development around those digital pieces as well. These are supplemental resources that I've used. Avid just developed a new site and made it available. You should be able to find it on their website, but if not, just email me and I'll put my email in the chat and I'll get it to you. Really great organization, but if you like Avid or if you use them at all, then they have now transitioned to some online resources. And then, you know, there's a lot of supplemental software out there. Read 180, System 44 are all from Scholastic, but there are, you know, there's iStation, there's Dreambox, there's iReady, there's Edmentum, there's Edgenuity, there's so much. You just want to make sure you're getting the right thing and you're using it the right way. I know with the remote learning, people who had Edgenuity, for example, were like, well, we'll just use Edgenuity. But Edgenuity is really designed for content credit recovery. So it's not your core instruction. It's supplemental, and it's supplemental in a very specific way. So, you know, just think about what you've got in your repository and what you're missing and try to fill those gaps as you're moving into next year. So in the chat window, why don't you tell me how many of you are currently using digital supplemental resources in your district? And I see we have a I Love iReady, so somebody's using it. What else might you be using in your districts? Share with everybody that we're crowdsourcing here. Come on. Don't be shy. There's 70 people here. Freckle, Mayon. Oh, I love Mayon. Raz Kids. Mylexia. Yep. Raz Kids. IXL. Love that too. Ooh, Laura's got Wide Open School already. Good, good. All right. Dreambox. I do love that. Nearpod. Yep. Nearpod can, I mean, they can do a lot of stuff. So, Spanish Duel. Claudia, do you like that? Using Dreambox for Spanish dual language? Does it meet your needs? Yeah, Nearpod is amazing. Brain Pop. Oh, my friend Carrie would be over the moon to see Brain Pop mentioned here. Okay, good. Thank you, Claudia. What about for special education? Do any of you have some recommendations for special ed software out there? Like, say, Core 5? Okay. Mine's System 44, but it's super expensive. Okay, good. Accelerated Reader. Yeah, we talked about that. Do you know it? Okay, good. Excellent. Yeah, oh yeah, Khan Academy. Yep. Okay. Well, those are all really great supplemental resources, and they're not overpriced. They're not terribly, you know, high priced. Like I said, the System 44 is kind of high, and there is a product called Waterford. I don't even know, that may not be available anymore. It may have sold, but it was a really good product, but really expensive. Rosetta Stone for newcomers. Oh, thanks, Claudia. But open education resources are another type of content that we can absolutely take advantage of. And the open education resources, we had a great conversation in my last session on this, because a lot of people thought OER meant free, and it doesn't mean free. There are some OER out there that are fee-based, and it has to be, because even though they're developing it in a way that is to be shared, there still could be a cost to that that needs to be passed on. It's certainly not a publisher's cost, but it is a cost that needs to be shared with the people who are using it. So Christina Ishmael is I consider her the guru of OER. She is passionate about it. She worked at the U.S. Department of Ed and kind of kicked off the OER initiative for the U.S. Department of Ed once upon a time, a long time ago, feels like a really long time ago. And so she has now moved to a new organization. We were trying to figure out in the last one where she landed. Somebody said New America, but then somebody said, I don't know. But so if you know Christine, you know, Christina, you know that she's just gotten a new position in a new place. And she's the queen of OER. And what is important to note with OER is there are, you know, just like anything else, there's different shades of it. There's different degrees of it. And you really want to try to get the best quality that's out there. So, you know, look for OER Commons. Nebraska has a really great resource called OER Commons that's available. New York has a really good resource for OER. And then there's some companies that actually have really good resources for OER. But it is an option when you are thinking about delivering content. And then teachers designing content is, you know, it's something that you want your teachers to do. I did anyway. I just want them to have the right tools to do it in. The two tools that I think are the coolest and easiest for teachers to use are Canva and S'more. There could be other, there's Adobe Spark. So those are probably the three tools I think that I like the most for teachers to create content in. They can definitely create it in a Microsoft or Google system, but these systems are kind of design centric and allow them to just create really cool designs in their lessons. And then those lessons can be made available in a learning management system. So be sure you think through that and think about providing them an option for teacher created content. If you don't think through it, and if you don't think about an option for them, they'll just come up with one on their own, and you might not be comfortable with that option. So it's always better. Oh, good. Thank you, Sarah. That's what we thought, but we weren't sure. You know, just make sure that make sure they know that there's an option out there. And those two are free. Somebody said S'more wasn't, but I've got S'more and I've got the free version of it and I love it. And you know, I can't do as much. I've had to upgrade and pay for the Canva version because I really, really like that. And Adobe Spark is free too. So those are some really good options for teacher created content. Now, as you're getting into this digital space, you're going to be needing to sharpen your skills on digital citizenship. It's one of ISTE's standards for leaders, for students. So you gotta key in on that. This is a really great graphic by Sandy Liptak that talks about kind of all the different pieces, the different components of digital citizenship from a kind of a a really simplified way to look at it. One of the things that I told my teachers when they wanted to start designing content and kind of getting out there is, if you're going to put content out that's going to be searchable, then you want to make sure when I put your name in that I'm not going to find a picture of you like drinking a big keg of beer with a bikini top on. Like, you just need to make sure that your footprint is as clean as possible when you start putting your own teacher content out there. So teach your teachers about digital citizenship as well as your students. And there's some really great resources on the ISTE website to do that. Now let's take a look at how we use content and collect data. Of course, naturally, we all want to be familiar with the data privacy requirements that are out there. Probably Illinois and California have some of the tighter laws around data privacy. Illinois goes into effect in July, but California's was the first one on the books. So from the first to the last, there's a varying degree of privacy laws out there. Susan Gentz, who's running a track on policy, could tell you a lot about the laws that are out there, but do pay attention to that. And I'm going to geek out for you for a little bit and talk about how we help, you know, kind of how you collect your data. So if you've got really tight systems and those systems are going into like an Azure or some kind of a cloud warehouse system, then you can pull that data out through, if you're using Azure Power BI, and really have some dynamic reports that allow you to see what's going on with your students' learning. So what I would encourage you to do is think about how the type of content that you're creating, the learning platform that you've built, and how you've integrated that learning platform with a data warehousing system or data reporting system. And then use that data system on a very regular basis so that you can see how the students are performing and you can use that information to drive your instruction. This is all something that you're probably saying, duh, Kecia, we exactly know how to do that. But you may not have the infrastructure. I'm working with a lot of districts right now and only one has the infrastructure in play to really pull this off. So it's not easy to get this infrastructure, but if you can prioritize it, especially with your stimulus monies that are coming in, I don't know how you're going to spend them, but if you could use them to build this infrastructure for yourself, it would be a well made investment. This is what data walls looked like back in the day. Look at that. All the cards, all the library pockets, and, you know, where my kids are. Are they a orange? Are they a yellow? Are they off the charts? Like, where are my kids? And this is what it looks like when you have a data warehouse and a data system. So if you can get to a place where you can have a really dynamic way to collect data and review data, then you can actually make better decisions about your instructional methodologies, the content that you're selecting, your practices, you know, what your teachers are doing with the training that you've prepared for them. All of that can be better when you have better data to guide your instruction. So if I get it all together, then I don't know where I'll put it. There's a lot in this presentation for you to digest. There's a lot around content and there's a lot around data, but I do think that it will make it better and easier for you to start school next year if you can just get started around your content and around your kind of data needs. So I have one other friend that I want to show you, and he's got some special news about something going on this summer. And then I'm going to turn it over to Marie, and I will see you guys back here, either hopefully back for another session, or maybe I'll see you next week on my webinar. So I'm so thankful that you spent some time with me, and let's hear from Richard.
Hi, my name is Richard Colada. I am the CEO of ISTE. Kecia, thank you for giving me the opportunity to join you today and for this great event, and really glad that everybody is able to be here. And also thanks for giving me just a minute to share with you a preview of coming attractions, something cool that we are doing at ISTE. For those of you who maybe don't know what ISTE is, we are a nonprofit organization, and our goal is, and has been for 40 years, is to help teachers use technology more effectively for teaching and learning. And so we do that in a variety of different ways. We have a certification program, we do events, we have a whole variety of resources that we provide. But as we have been talking to school leaders, to district leaders, to teachers, one of the things we hear over and over again was we did, you know, heroic efforts to transition to using technology for teaching and learning in a very short amount of time. And that got us through to the end of this school year. But as we look towards the fall, in almost every case, there's still some form of blended learning, even possibly online learning, and a whole variety of ways that technology is going to continue to be used for the foreseeable future. And one of the things that we've heard is that the quick getting up to speed, while it was helpful for the moment that we were in, as we think about long-term, There's a greater level of depth that we need around this. We need to know how to do better collaboration in virtual spaces. We need to know how to do assessment that's authentic and awesome, and not just multiple choice or uploading worksheets, right? We need to know how to handle special populations, students with special needs, English language learners in a virtual space. So at ISTE, we're creating what we're calling the Summer Learning Academy. And the Summer Learning Academy is a great opportunity for 2 weeks over the summer, starting in July, for teachers to come together and participate in four mini courses that are 2 hours each, and then listen to a whole bunch of the experts in learning with technology that we've curated, that we've pulled together from around the world, and then also have a chance to share best practices with all of the other educators going through this cohort. So it's a great experience, and would love to have you be able to join us this summer. It starts in July, and you can find out more information about it by going to summerlearningacademy.iste.org. And if you go there, you'll see some of our experts, you'll see more information about the courses, and you'll be able to register right there. So thanks again for having me join you for this great event, and really looking forward to seeing you and your colleagues and your friends on ISTE for our Summer Learning Academy coming up. Thanks so much.
On behalf of our entire team, thank you for attending today's Tech and Learning Future Proofing Your District Plan Conference. A special thank you to our sponsors, CatchOn, Classcraft, FileWave, Global Teletherapy, GradeCam, Sanford Programs, and thank you to all of our association partners. Please join me in thanking our terrific speakers today, and I want to thank each and every one of you for joining us and spending this time together. And don't forget to register for next week's Tech and Learning Roundtable webinar on Wednesday, June 3rd. Join Dr. Kecia Ray as she speaks with district leaders about the security issues related to online learning as school plan for next year, such as keeping data private, cybersecurity concerns, and monitoring online activity to make sure students are safe and content is appropriate. Please register by visiting www.techlearning.com/events. We look forward to getting together with you all again in person soon. Until then, stay safe and healthy.